I, Shirley Dean, Mayor of the City of Berkeley, do hereby recognize and congratulate the International Gilbert and Sullivan Festival by proclaiming June 13th through the 22nd, 1997, as International Gilbert and Sullivan Week in the City of Berkeley.
I declare the 4th International Gilbert and Sullivan Festival open.
We sail the ocean blue and saucy ships of beauty. We're sober men and true, attentive to our duty. Our saucy ships of beauty, we're attentive to our duty. We're sober men and true, we sail the ocean blue.
Yes, how are you? No, I'd be delighted. I'd rather be giving you the interview in San Francisco, but if we've to do it by phone, we'll do it by phone.
Morning, Simon. Neil Smith from the Gilbert and Sullivan Festival in England. How are you doing?
Neil Smith is my son, and he is the festival secretary. Oh, it's the biggest event in Gilbert and Sullivan terms that the world has ever seen. Yeah. We're expecting something like 35,000 visitors in total to the three venues, 35 nights, something like 50 full-scale productions from societies from across North America, all over the United Kingdom and Ireland. We're desperate to preserve the heritage of Gilbert and Sullivan. Not in any fuddy-duddy way, but they've been going now for more than 125 years, and I'd like to think that we're going to preserve it in very much the traditional manner for another 125 years.
The ward of Coco, in pity speak, oh speak, I pray you.
I think I was 10 and my mother was a singer, and she decided that her little boy was going to be the page boy to Coco in the Mikado, and that's how it began. And then I have three very young children. They're not quite old enough to perform, but I have high hopes. They're certainly showing a lot of musical inclinations.
And we thank you for joining us at Classical 102.1 KDFC, San Francisco. It's been said that somewhere in the world there's always someone singing Gilbert and Sullivan. Well, that is certainly true today here in the sunny San Francisco Bay Area, where the stars from the original doily cart share the stage with amateurs in 10 days of merry festivities. Book now at the Zellerbach Hall in Berkeley.
I had a dream that began when the doily cart closed in 1982.
Why am I here? Because I've loved and sung these songs, my friends and people all of my life. The love songs I've made love to with women in a way that only a great man could write music and a great writer could write words that could court.
My dream, basically, was a festival that was going to take Gilbert and Sullivan to many parts of the world.
If you want to know who we are children of Japan.
Sylvie's ancient songs and stories are told again and again for 100 years, Gilbert and Sullivan, as long as we sing English.
The press cutting, San Francisco Chronicle, Monday, June 16th. A masterful Mikado. Gilbert and Sullivan Festival opens with spirited wit. The newly formed Gilbert and Sullivan Opera Company provided melody and merriment in equal measure, romping through one of the most deservedly popular works in the Savoy canon.
In trances, to a height that few can scale, save by long and weary dances, surely never had a male. Under such like circumstances, so adventurous a tale, which may rank with most romances, taken from a county jail. By a set of curious chances, surely never had a male so adventurous a tale.
Yippee!
Richard Doyley Cart was the theatrical impresario who brought Gilbert and Sullivan together in the early 1870s, a rather colourful, slightly exotic figure from the theatrical world of Soho. And I think without him, they wouldn't have been brought together. And he also established the company, the sole raison d'etre of which was to perform the Gilbert and Sullivan operas. And it was that company which went on right through until 1982, performing G&S and nothing but G&S.
The sun whose rays are all ablaze with ever-living glory does not deny his majesty, he scorns to tell a story. He don't exclaim, I blush for shame, so kindly be indulgent. But fierce and bold in fiery gold,
what Ian Smith is trying to do in this festival is to take the old Doyley Cart stars and get them to pass on, almost like the Holy Grail, pass on the tradition to another generation.
Five or six years ago, there was a very real danger that Gilbert and Sullivan was just going to go off the map. And the concept was to try and merge or mix the enthusiastic amateurs who wanted to go on stage and perform with the big names, former stars who wanted to impart their knowledge.
Life is a joke, that's just begun.
I mean, it's been a very exciting 4 years. We've seen truly just how wide the spread of Gilbert and Sullivan is around the world. How many do you think you sold at that number?
Well, let's find out. The orchestra floor. There's a lot left. But
obviously got a good sense of it.
Yes. The mezzanine has a lot of space also.
Right. I'm thinking that what we'll do is close the top level. So my suggestion is we take the back three rows of the mezzanine and we say to people up on the balcony, you can go and fill any of those back three. Tell the box office not to sell any of those.
When you're lying awake with a dismal headache that reposes tabooed by anxiety, I conceive you may use any language you choose to indulge in without impropriety. For your brain is on fire, the bedlers conspire of usual slumber to plunder you. First your counterpane goes and uncovers your toes, and your sheet slips demurely from under you. Then the blanketing tingles, you feel like mixed pickles, so terribly sharp is the pricking. And you're hot and you cross and you tumble and toss till there's nothing fixed you and the ticking.
Gilbert wrote this rather interesting song in Iolanthe, which is called the Nightmare Song. The words say exactly what sort of a night it was.
And, you know, I think it's probably...
It's a thing that I think Ian has supported to an unbelievable extent. And financially, it, at the moment, you know, it's got to be successful this year. This is the absolute watershed. We've sweated blood over the festival over the last 3 years.
Here in San Francisco, what we're going to be doing, we're going to be singing one number from each of the 13 operas in 13 interesting, historical, and perhaps on a couple of occasions, amusing locations.
Now for the muffin and toast, and now for the gay Sullivan. The eggs and the ham and the strawberry jam, the rollicking bun and the gay Sullivan.
Did the sorcerer, Judy was on stage pregnant with Brenna, our eldest.
My name is John Wellington Wells. I'm a dealer in magic and spells, in blessings and curses and never filled purses, in prophecies, witches and knows. If you want a proud pair to make tricks, if you'd melt a rich uncle in wax, you've but to look in on the resident gin number 70 Simmery X.
If I had to choose something that I would want to do for, like, till I died, it would be Gilbert and Sullivan.
Well,
definitely.
We met during Iolanthe, which was my first show.
And I wasn't in that show.
And Matt wasn't in the show, but Matt was always around.
Hanging around.
Hanging
because
around.
I had no life otherwise.
Yes. Do you want to tell the
story? Yeah, she was seeing, the long and short of it is that she was seeing another guy during Iolanthe. I kissed her and she dumped it. And that was it.
I met my husband through the Gilbert and Sullivan Festival. He was a participant in 95 at the festival in Buxton. We met on the last night of the festival, and we were married last November, and I now live in Philadelphia. So the best thing that's ever happened to me came out of the festival and Gilbert and Sullivan, so a fairy tale ending.
It is a glorious thing to be a pirate king, for I am a pirate king. And it is a glorious thing to be a pirate king.
It is the world of the pirate king, the world of the pirate king.
I was very blessed. My father liked Gilbert and Sullivan. One day he took me as a surprise. This is back in the 50s. To see a production of the wonderful British production Martin Green. And then he prepared me each year. The Doyle cart would come, and he'd get one of the records, and he'd listen to it. Well, by this time I was hooked. I chose, when I knew the Gilbert and Sullivan Festival was coming, to block out some time for vacation, because this nurtures the soul. One, it's witty, fun, and bright, you know. Two, I can be an Anglophile without any need to apologize. And three, I am touched and moved by the amount of artistry, caring, and love that the artists do for this work.
Can I say what a pleasure and how excited we are to be working with you all. Mm-hmm. I'm Coco. I'm going to introduce you to Katisha. Where's Katisha? Katisha is going down in a minute. The very big gentleman there is Pooh Bah, right?
Well, I've been doing Pooh Bah for about,
34, 35 years. I started when I was about 25 or 6 doing pool bar. It's the first part I ever played, and it's probably going to be the last part I play.
Ah, Pooh Bah! It seems that the festivities in connection with my approaching marriage must last a week.
Now, like of course, the Mikado appears to be a satire about what's going on in Japan.
To spend upon them.
But in fact, of course, it's entirely a satire, really, on all things British and on the British love of the establishment of sinecures of somebody doing more than one job.
In which of my capacities? First Lord of the Treasury, Lord Chamberlain, Attorney General, Chancellor of the Exchequer, Privy Purse, or Private Secretary.
Children start typically about 5 years old and can go until 14. After that time, they have to move on. The group has grown tremendously. As soon as they got the publicity about our trip to Buxton, everyone wanted to join the Children's Chorale, so it went from about 30 kids up to almost 70 children this year.
Ian Smith is a blessing and a gift to the arts. Ian Smith and his daughter Belinda are sort of like the Helen and Doyle Cart of the last century. He weaves the children in again and again so that they will have the same love and appreciation that I in 1950 loved. Well, today it's 1990 and we saw children, eyes shining, all set to know what they're going to do next.
The tourist who knows everything about the Chardonnay, of course he really doesn't, but he knows just what to say. The butter and the oak in perfect harmony exist. He never would be missed. He never would be missed.
Listen, the bell tolls, the reminder of the passing of seasons or the passing of the day, just like in Yeoman of the Guard. A bell is tolled, and suddenly you're looking at life and death issues in the middle of a comic opera, and you are learning, and you are touched, and you are moved before you realize it has happened. You have been caught.
My name is Henry Carey. I perform with the Lamplighters in San Francisco, and I'm going to audition with the judge's song from Trial by Jury.
Thanks, Henry. Can we just have the second and third verses?
Westminster Hall, second verse is in Westminster Hall.
Yes, that's right.
I'm sorry.
So, don't worry. Start again, please.
Westminster Hall, I
danced a dance
like a
seven-disfallen
fury.
Satire. Well, British satire and all. It's the ability to look at something with affection and still a critical eye. Be able to laugh at something. It's be able to milk the sacred cows.
But I soon got tired of third-class journeys and dinners of bread and water. So I fell in love with the rich attorney's elderly, ugly daughter.
Thank you very much. You've seen the rehearsal schedule. Any problems?
It's just 9 o'clock Thursday. I can't miss this big meeting at work.
Okay. And you'll be there this evening?
Yes, I'll be there this evening for Kingan.
Good. So I'll be announcing the cast this evening.
My day job is a financial analyst. I was in a summer camp production of HMS Pinafore as a chorus member. And then later on, I saw it whenever I could.
Oh, yes.
Again.
with doing it as a festival production, it's wonderful because all the people there have already done it with other companies. They know the words and musics intimately, and all you do is pull them together and allow their natural enthusiasm to develop the plot.
I get a lot of pleasure out of performing them because I think they're timeless gems. I think because it's something that I'm relatively good at, it's nice to be able to do it on stage. And somehow it feels more right than doing musicals.
Henry will come in from here. We'll acknowledge the associate with a little bow, and you bow. Okay, you can wave at the girls, sneer at the defendant, and acknowledge the gentleman of the jury.
What was that?
Silent bee. It was the cat.
It was the cat.
They're right. It was the cat.
There we go. Savoynet is a group of about 300, 400 people. If you want to, you can think of it as a small village of 300 or 400 people. And it acts like a village. We have the village idiot, and we have the village teacher, and we have the one who most people can't stand. And,
Savoynet adopted the at symbol as a means of recognizing each other with badges. And I had this done. I did this on my computer and told a local firm I wanted that put onto a T-shirt.
We have five inmates still missing, and a few of these gentlemen look familiar, but I won't point out who they are.
Carefully on tiptoe ceiling, breathing gently as we may. Every step with caution feeling, we will softly steal away.
In 1948, at the age of 21, I became the youngest correctional officer guard to work here on Alcatraz, and I met men such as George Machine Gun Kelly, Alvin Creepy Carpus, Robert the Birdman Stroud. Of course, one of our first inmates here was Al Capone.
Was again the cat. They're right. It was the cat.
I really like Gilbert and Sullivan. You know, it reminds me, I've all these years, it's a joyful play to watch and to enjoy. And I'm certainly glad you were able to come here and present it here on the Rock.
Like that when a lad, a shocking young scamp of a rover, I behave like a regular cad, but that sort of thing is all over. I am now a respectable chap, and shine with a virtue resplendent, and therefore I haven't a scrap of sympathy with the defendant.
We all believed that the British were somewhat higher class than us. You know, we had maybe, perhaps we had more money now, but there was a certain superiority in being British. We thought British people were smarter. Yeah, more intellectual, all more intellectual, more refined.
For these kind words, accept my thanks, I pray. A breach of promise we've to try today.
Trial by jury, it's a breach of promise of marriage. And it's Gilbert and Sullivan sending up the English legal system. It's beautiful. It's the first piece they ever wrote. It was written as a curtain raiser to Offenbach's opera La Pericole, because anything foreign was thought of as wonderful in England. But within a few weeks, they changed it round that Pericole was the curtain raiser to trial by jury, because it had taken the place by storm.
All of this we make reply, to all of this we make reply, by the state of yonder sky, that we will bear.
Gilbert came of fairly well-to-do stock, a sort of country gentry in the southeast. He read for the bar and intended to be a barrister, but really failed at it. And I think his heart was always in literary endeavours. He wrote a lot of poems, the Bab Ballads, which are a marvellous collection of amusing poems. He was a bit like the sort of John Mortimer, I suppose, of the Victorian period.
To all their little weaknesses I open people's eyes, and little plans to snub the self-sufficient I devise. I love my fellow creatures, I do all the good I can. Yet everybody says I'm such a disagreeable man, and I can't think why.
That's supposed to be a self-portrait of Gilbert. He doesn't know why people think he's a disagreeable man when all he's trying to do is point out other people's flaws and help society in that way.
She may very well pass for 43 in the dusk with a light behind her. She may well pass for 43 in the dusk with a light behind her.
It's not too English for you.
No, it transcends the accent. Yeah. It doesn't matter where that is. You get a chance to be pirates. I mean, all of us grew up wanting to be pirates, right? This is my chance. I'm the pirate king for a change.
Nay, dear master, my mind has long been nagged by the cankering tooth of mystery.
To me, I'm Fred.
Better
I'm
have sorry, it
out. Typical, I know.
I'm You're Fred. Much cuter.
I took some vacation time because I heard the class was here and Peggy Ann Jones was here from England to help us with this. Since I'm playing the pirate king in just a month or less, I came to get some tips on how I should portray this character. I've never done something this large before.
Gilbert and Sullivan, written 1888. Life was a lot different then. But in actual fact, our feelings haven't changed. Our actions haven't changed. But we are still human beings. We're still people and we still think of things in the same way. There are people in these operas that you will know in your street. Because we still can recognize people like Ruth, who is desperate to get married, but just hasn't found the right man yet.
Suppose we take off our shoes and stockings and paddle.
Oh, yes, the very thing!
Great!
In Iolanthe, Sullivan creates this stately tune that reminds you of Rule Britannia, and that's funny. Everyone could see that the House of Lords is being sent up.
The House of Peers throughout the war did nothing in particular and did it very well.
But at the same time, that song became a hit as a parlor ballad. Sullivan once said there's no such thing as humor in music.
Yet Britain set over the place in good King George's glorious day.
When everything else in the world may be changing, the Gilbert Sullivan operas, in essence, are of a time that's gone by. It's England as it was once, and it probably never was.
It's interesting that some of the critics of Gilbert and Sullivan, some of the most vociferous critics, of course, including those like Lord Hills, who wrote to the Times a few years ago suggesting that all Gilbert and Sullivan performances should be banned for 5 years because it was holding up Britain's industrial progress. The critics feel that it is part of the British disease, of course, of constantly looking back, of constantly living in the last century.
As quick as we can now, boys and girls, back onto the buses. Across the bridge.
People like this see the whole Gilbert and Sullivan cult as positively pernicious. But then one's got to say, why is G&S so popular in America, a country which is booming with energy and dynamism and looking forward? Why is it popular in Germany and Japan?
Efter bin ich fett a bissel, del Fall sche kleine Putterschüssel, del Norman is wie a Geschwier.
Less than a week ago, these people came together to put on Trial by Jury. It's the company show. People walk through the door, they're strangers. Now they're going to put on a work of art together.
Oh, God. 5 hours rehearsal and they're going on in 10 minutes.
Yes.
think everybody who's been have enjoyed the shows. I think the standard generally has been very high.
We've been anxiously watching ticket sales to see, firstly, can we pay for the theatre? Can we pay for this? Can we pay for that? And, you know, it's crept up, but the whole week has been focused around whether or not the festival's going to make, you know, break even here in Berkeley.
I would say it's been very disappointing. The tickets have not gone remotely as we would have wished. Normally, if you're going to go into the United States in a big professional 2,000-seat theatre, you would expect to have $100,000 promotion money, advertising-like. We just haven't got that money.
Much I'd spend to gain my end. Faint heart never won. Said they,
never, never, never. Faint heart never won. Said they.
Ian, particularly because of the massive financial risk that he's put his company and himself personally under. And I think that this week has really been very testing for him.
Nothing venture, nothing will. Blood is thick, but water's thin. In for a penny, in for a pound. There's love that makes the world go round. Nothing venture, nothing will. Blood is thick, but water's thin. In for a penny, in for a pound. It's love that makes the world go round.
If we look over the two venues in the United States, we've round about $100,000 of loss, excluding time. The only way we've been able to cover losses is that my company has had to find that cash. It's knocked us down very considerably, but we shall be bouncing back.
Tuneful, isn't it? Yes. And it's light-hearted, frequently satirical. In a way, it's a little bit like Shaw, in that it educates as well as entertains.
As office boy, I made sure to mark that they gave me the post of a junior clerk. I served the writs with a smile so bland, and I copied all the letters in a big round hand.
I think any rising, you know, politician should study his Gilbert and Sullivan very carefully, because I think it gives a very good, healthy, cynical approach to politics.
Of legal knowledge, I acquired such a grip that they took me into the partnership. And that junior partnership, I ween, was the only ship I ever had seen. But that kind of ship so suited me that now I'm the ruler of the Queen's Navy.
It's an instant merriment, I think. That's what I think, that everybody must feel that way. Instant merriment.
Much better than Prozac.
Certainly, the obsessive fans that I know are nearly all men. An awful lot of clergymen seem to be very interested in Gilbert and Sullivan. I'm a minister in the Church of Scotland, so I'm one of the many clergy groupies of Gilbert and Sullivan.
And particularly today, we come to celebrate the God-given talents and the unique partnership of W.S. Gilbert and Arthur Sullivan. And especially this morning to pray for Henry and Charles Smith. Henry Alexander, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And I sign you with the sign of the cross.
My worry is now for Oliver and the twins, because, you know, when they're of an age that they are going to be doing Gilbert and Sullivan themselves, who's going to be there to teach them?
With Gilbert was really quite difficult, because Gilbert loved the light operetta and Sullivan was slightly ashamed of it. He himself was very disappointed in his life that his more serious works were not appreciated. His symphony is really very, very fine, and I'm going to record it for the centenary of his death in 2000.
Brothers, we are
California or Philadelphia met really what we were hoping it would, whereas Buxton is surpassing it. I think the atmosphere in Buxton is better this year than perhaps ever.
He works awfully hard, that man. He loves GNS so much, dear, I think, and he wants to keep it alive. But for him, darling, they would not be here this weekend. I mean, you can see it yourself. You just walk around and see their faces, and they're all having such a wonderful time. And it's like, I've told you before, it's like an instant merriment. But this is not instant, it just carried on, hasn't it? Wonderful folk.
There is nothing brings it round like the trumpet's martial sound, like the trumpet's martial sound. Tarantara, tarantara, tarantara.
It's been a renaissance. I mean, it's just going back to the same feelings we had when we were in the company. The Doyle Quartet is the only company in the world that worked for a whole year on one composer's music.
It's sung with the ring of the souls meeting, who love with a love lifelong. It's a song of a merrymate, really proud, who loved a lord and who laughed aloud at the moan of the merry man, moping mum, whose soul was silent, whose glance was glum, who sipped no supper, to crave no crumb, as he sighed for the love of a lady.
It hurts me deeply that the schools of music neglect them so much. I mean, when do our colleges, when does the Guildhall, when does the Academy, the Manchester College, put on a Gilbert and Sullivan opera? We can say, I think, never.
It is sung to the knell of a churchyard bell and a doleful dirge ding-dong. It's a song of a popinjay bravely born, who turned up his noble nose with scorn at the humble merrymaid, purely proud, who loved a lord and who laughed aloud at the moan of the merry man, moping mum, whose soul was sad and whose glance was glum, who sipped no sup and who craved no crumb as he sighed for the love of a lady.
Because it came out of a 19th century tradition, when everybody played the piano and people sang hymns and part songs in their parlours in what we now see as a classical sort of way. In fact, that's what popular music was then. But it then becomes subject to all kinds of snobbery, because it isn't. I mean, you know, Wagner it isn't, Mozart it isn't. The influences of Mozart and Schubert and Mendelssohn and so forth are all there in Sullivan, but it is, it was popular.
Never mind why and wherefore, love your level ranks and therefore, though your nautical relation in my set would scarcely pass, though you occupy a station in the lower middle class.
I think GNS has suffered terribly from the snobbery of the intelligentsia over the years. I remember I had a formidable great aunt
in my childhood, and when she heard that I liked Gilbert and Sullivan, she said, people who like Gilbert and Sullivan shop at Liberty's. And I've no idea what she meant.
You sort of become a closet Gilbert and Sullivan freak because it's so un-PC and it's so regarded as being so utterly and totally decadent and artless and sort of camp and Victorian and fossilised and just about everything else that people can be negative about in their snobbish way, that you sort of shut up about it and finally you do only whistle it in the bath. Give it to healthy young people with no prejudices or preconceptions, and it turns out that it's rather wonderful and theatrical and musically rich popular entertainment.
Well, it was certainly a stepping stone for me. I mean, through understanding Gilbert and Sullivan and getting really inside Gilbert and Sullivan, then you start listening to Mozart after that, and it's not difficult. You're prepared, it's easy. And Verdi and Rossini and all those mainstream opera composers are that much more available to you.
Genius is written for men, and a real challenge is how to make it interesting for the girls so that they can have fun as well.
Free this maid to all unwary, come from the ladies' seminary, free from the genius tutelary. Three little maids from school, three little maids from school.
This music is so different to the kind of music that we actually listen to outside of school. It just gives us that different, you know, variety of music.
Take the maiden fair in her loveliness. Is the pretty face like the coralline. Emphasize the grace of her ladyship.
The targets in Gilbert and Sullivan are very much the same today as they were when he wrote it. Part of our cultural heritage that isn't being explored enough. It provides you with a real intellectual energy because it offers you challenges. I think it's wonderful and very much underrated.
There is beauty in extreme old age. Do you fancy you are elderly enough? Information I'm requesting on a subject interesting is a maiden all the better when she's tough.
Ooh, and the wide dominion is the general opinion that she lasts a great deal longer when she's tough.
Are you old enough to marry, do you think? Don't you wait until you're 80 in the shade? There's a fascination frantic in a ruin that's romantic. Do you think you are sufficiently decayed?
If you look at France and Germany and Austria and so on, all the youngsters appreciate their music. It can be Verdi, it can be Puccini, it can be anything, but they're brought up on it, and as well as going to the football matches, they go to the opera. We don't do that now in this country. And the thing that I think Ian is doing is regenerating, bringing in a whole new generation of people who will like to come. I hope it's going to be successful.
I thought it was absolutely fabulous. Totally innovative. It's great for the festival to see something that isn't traditional and that's, you know, slightly different. The audience are loving it. We're loving it. Just great to see them here.
I am the monarch of the sea, the ruler of the Queen's Navy, whose praise Great Britain loudly chants.
And so do his sisters and his cousins and his aunts.
When at anchor here I ride, my bosom swells with pride, and I snap my fingers at a foeman's taunts. But when the breezes blow, I generally go below and seek the seclusion that the cabin grants.
I would love to see comedians like Harry Enfield and Stephen Fry in productions of the Mikado or whatever, and I'd love to see English National Opera and the National Theatre do more productions of GNS.
Now, landsmen all, whoever you may be, if you want to rise from the top of the tree, if your soul isn't fettered to an office stool, be careful to be guided by this golden rule.
Be careful to be guided by this golden rule.
Stick close to your desks and never go to sea. And you all may be rulers of the Queen's Navy.